Oh, yeah, it says live up there, so
Right. So, I know that we've talked about, Jessica and I just talked about in the Google Doc how we each need to pick a color once we go on it next, so that way we know who's editing stuff or putting stuff in. Because that way we got confused, like who was putting in what and all that. So I guess today we're just going to talk about, I guess our topic is reimagining or reimagined online learning. So like, how are we going to solve it? What evidence are we going to use? And then how are we going to address the issue? And then we can decide like who wants to do what and that kind of thing.
Okay. Sounds good.
Do you guys have any where you want to start with it or anything?
I'm trying to pull up the Google Doc too right now.
Oh yeah, good idea. I'm gonna do
At
that.
the same time, so I can see what we
I'll pull it up too. So I guess maybe the first thing would be like with online learning, it's becoming such a big thing. Like how would we solve it maybe? Like what tools would we use to solve it? And I know that we have added Jessica and I, have you added stuff on there, Cassandra?
I tried. I think I was typing over someone though, so I stopped. So we should definitely
Okay.
do the color thing. I realized yesterday I was editing at the same time as someone else.
I think you were doing it when I, because it popped up
Oh,
like someone
okay.
else was doing it, so I think it
Okay.
may have been you. Okay, so I don't know, like I guess where it says like ways to solve. I know that's we have to figure out how we're gonna solve it. I don't know what he's looking for there. Do you guys have any?
I guess because that's right. I was a little confused too because it says, like, I don't know. I guess I mean, it's supposed to be like a hard problem to solve, but it's so broad.
Right.
Because he could mean like online learning, like students doing whole classes online, or he could mean online learning, like students using pieces of like online learning, like in a class. So I guess I didn't know if there was a certain way he wanted us to look at it, or guess if that was up to our interpretation, like can we look at it how we want?
I think we can
So,
look at it how we want. So, I know from like my perspective as like a blended learning teacher, I'm doing this all day long just using it. I don't know if you guys have ever used iReady or have heard of iReady, but it's they all have their individual logins and it tracks the data with like real-time feedback, which I know it's the frequent formative assessments and instant feedback was put on there, and it's something that solves it like right then and there. And that's like my school's three big other ones are Discovery Education and then using BrainPop for like just that smaller group interactive stuff.
Because like at my school we have like our own platform that my school kind of designed, but it's like housed online too, so like every teacher can put all of their stuff on there. So like, because I work in like in Detroit, an urban setting, so like our students don't always come to school as regularly as they should. So like we have a platform where everything's housed online so that like students can access it no matter like if they're at school or if they're, you know, if they are gone for a week or two because they can't get to school.
So are all your lessons on there too, like your actual teaching? Like
So every teacher like will upload videos that they make. They'll upload or they'll link to videos that they use. So pretty much everything that you do in class, you put on there as well. And that also helps in class because we like have students who are like in English 9 or 10 or math, like Algebra 1 or Geometry, and they're at like a second or third grade math or reading level. So it like allows the teachers to like put all their content on there so that the students can like have access to it at any time.
that's a good idea. That's like our iReady. It's like they can log on to it. It's just a web-based program, so they can log on from home. Same thing with Discovery Education. They can just go to like discoveryeducation.com, log in with their student ID and password. And then as a teacher, like we can assign them videos or worksheets or quizzes to do online and get that data like right then and there, like you guys.
Yeah, so this whoever put, well, do colors, but it says like using something like Blackboard, it's kind of similar
Okay.
It's a little more interactive than Blackboard, but it has a similar concept where everything's just there for them.
Okay.
So I think this is kind of the problem then that they're talking about is all these things are available already, so we already can get the information online. So I'm wondering if the actual wicked problem is making the kids, you know, engaged and not just clicking around or just watching a video or taking a quick assessment.
Like making it meaningful to them as opposed to just, because I've watched the kids use these online programs and they just click, 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 and it's like, first of all, I know you can read at like a third grade level, but you're doing all your work at kindergarten because you chose to do it the wrong way. So yeah. I don't know who posted that big quote at the top. Is that from the document that he sent out, like that the problem was based on?
Yeah, I was just sick of flipping back and forth. I like to enjoy that.
So I looked at that too, and I think it is like we have all these things in front of us, but we like aren't maybe using them in the right way. Like it's just like I feel like sometimes it's just seen as it's just like, oh, well, this can take away from like me teaching for the day, so I'll just put them on this, and then it's like you get the data, but you don't necessarily follow up with it to make it meaningful to really help the kids with it.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, how can we make it meaningful?
Because I feel like in my school with our platform, we have, like, no one's really in the middle. It's, like, either you have people who are very, like you just said, like, just put everything on there and the kid just kind of click through it and they're getting their data. Or we have people who, like, are really, really resistant to utilizing it. So they have students who are like falling way behind because they don't come as regularly, but the teacher just won't put it on there or like doesn't necessarily have the technology skills to use it. So I feel like it kind of goes from one opposite, like one end of the spectrum to the other with like issues with it.
Yeah. I was just looking at the quote from that thing that was posted and it just says, students expect learning that matters, learning connected in timely ways to the real world, learning that engages their interest. So I think it has to do like using those online programs, but making it meaningful, but that's an awesome way to connect to, because obviously he wants us to use the G reading, so we could always connect and being like, well, we're more likely to remember stuff or use our memory when it's meaningful and connecting. So that would be an awesome way to connect those, our idea and then the reading together.
Yeah. Yeah, the G reading where it says, like, I focus a lot on this in my paper, the circuit of reflective action, where, like, you need mentorship. So, like, you can't just put a student on the computer if they have no background knowledge and they still need, like, the teacher's mentorship. Like, you can use the computer, but they need a mentor in it.
So would we need, like, a specific program to solve it or just, like, a group of ideas? That's what I'm confused. Like, do we need a specific program or do we just need, like, these are things you can do to solve online learning?
I think we need to, like, say we could use a program. I don't think it matters if it's a real one. Like, I think we have to say, well, we'd use authentic learning by doing, this and this and this and, like, peer mentorships as well as teacher. But I don't think we have to come up with the specific programs because he said it doesn't have to be real.
Okay. So we could say, like, we could solve it by doing peer mentorship, authentic learning. Sorry, I'm, like, writing this down so that we don't forget it.
Oh, that's good.
Peer mentorship, authentic learning. I like the project-based learning and then the differentiated learning, too.
I'm doing a lot of project-based right now. I'm piloting for Scholastic, and I'm realizing how engaged my students are. We're doing an online blog about a nature center nearby, but I was thinking if we did something like that where they could do it wherever they are, something that they have a real-world audience, so either a blog or a video. Like, I don't know how deep into this we have to get. Are we getting
that? Yeah, that's if we have to use a specific example, I think that'd be a good one to do, like, have them do a blog. Because, like, kids like writing, especially when it's about themselves. So if they can write about themselves on that project-based learning and use your example, and then I can pull in from, we could use, like, maybe they need to learn about the, like, what a forest is or something like that, where they're about a nature park and could pull from Discovery Ed, and that could be the blended learning or the online learning, and then making it that real authentic project base through the blogging.
What for things and move? Oh, there it goes.
I kept muting it because it needs the echo. I think that's me causing that listen too. So should we, do we need to ask him, I guess, how, should we take these ideas to Bill and say, what do you want us to actually write? Or do we want to just start something?
What could we do? Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, go ahead, Cassandra.
Could we do like, I don't know how to say, I don't want to say more than one because it makes it sound like it's more work, but can we just like do like a couple like pieces of how like we could reimagine online learning? So maybe pick like two or three like really strong ways we could do it, and then like focus on like a couple ways, like really solid ways that teachers could integrate it into their classroom a little like.
I like that idea, like using, so like picking between like the peer mentorship, authentic learning, project-based, or differentiating instruction. So like pick between, like pick two of those is what you're saying, and then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because so, I feel like online could do, like if we focus on one, we might be making it too narrow, but if we focus on too many, we won't be able to like really, like, it'll be too broad. So maybe if we pick like maybe two or three, and we say like, here's three like solid ways that like,
I like going like with solutions. Two, and if for some reason that we're just not finding enough on those two, then maybe go with three, but I don't want to like overwhelm us with picking three. So maybe if we do two, and then within those two ideas, pick like the technology tools that can support to make it authentic or to make it project based.
Because like one way we do it, and then, but this goes with like project based, is we really use ours so that we do like standards based grading. And so they can't like move from one standard to the next until they've mastered it. And so like the online tool is so like great for that, because then the teacher isn't having to like find a million resources or like always be there for the student.
Right.
The teacher can like just give them all these different opportunities right there, like at their fingertips. So
I guess that kind of, it answers the question, like how will we solve it? I guess it kind of answers like how we address the issue. I don't know what you guys think about that. I know one of the things is like, how are we going to address the issue and like, why is it important or something like that?
Yeah, I'm trying to pull up that other one too, because I tried to reset my computer and now all my tabs went away. Does anybody have the actual, I'm trying to pull it up now, but like the actual.
I have it right. Yes. Okay. It just says, I don't know where Jessica went.
No, I don't know.
It just says, how would you address this issue and why? So, like, how, like, if we were presenting it to policymakers, like, how would we justify doing it? Which I think would be, like, you're making it meaningful, you're making it, you know, like, based to that student to help them succeed, as opposed to just being, like, here's your third grade stuff, like, do it. What if they're not at a third grade level? Like, that's not really beneficial to them.
So I say, yeah, I say if that's how we're doing, I think we pick just two, and then we just say like, here's two like really solid ways that we can use this.
Okay. So I like the idea of authentic learning because that will be very like connecting to be the G reading. So do you want to focus on authentic reading for one of them?
Yeah, I think so too.
What about the other one? And we'll get Jessica's input when she comes back.
Okay.
Oh, there she is.
I don't see her though.
I just see her picture. Because we could do, so if we do authentic learning that connects to making it meaningful, I think that you and Jessica have really good ideas on project-based learning. Would we want to do that?
Yeah, I think that's a good one. Because we can incorporate, and we can kind of tie. Oh, is that Jessica talking?
No, I don't know. I feel like within project-based learning, like, you can incorporate the peer mentorship and differentiated instruction.
Agreed, yeah.
All right. So if we focus on those, and then the research, we can use G for one of them, and then we could each maybe just find, like, an article that has to do with it.
Like, another source besides G.
Yeah, so
I think for both of those topics, we could find some pretty good articles, since they're such big pushes right now.
I don't think it has to be, like, through the MSU libraries or anything. So okay. I think, like, we could even go to, like, Edutopia or something like that. I posted some links on the online on the Google Doc. There's just a couple things on there. If one was, like, a TED video, one was reimagining education. So if we, like, want to go through and, like, pick which one maybe, like, we want to focus on more.
Okay.
And then something to support, like, the project-based learning aspect of it.
Okay, so articles. I'm just going to type at the bottom, so we're going to focus on authentic learning and project-based learning.
So you could say, like, focus on authentic learning and project-based learning, supporting, I don't know. I guess I'll watch you finish typing.
I was just trying to, like, get our thoughts out so I could, like, make sure I know what I'm looking for.
I have my iPad in front of me, so I was, like, watching you. I like that. So it's two ways to reimagine online learning. I was going to say within those ways, like, focusing on, I don't know how to word it, but, like, something with a differentiated instruction, because I feel like that's the whole point of online learning is to give them that individualized path.
I agree, because, I mean, that's, like, yeah. I mean, we utilize it just to be able to, like, have kids in the third grade math and all the way to a ninth grade math, like, in a room. We just use that to, like, give them different resources.
Right. So we, I don't know. I'm
or
fine
could
with
we,
that.
Should we can, maybe should we can bind, like, project-based learning and authentic learning into, like, a topic and then do, like, a differentiated instruction as our other topic because they kind of go hand in hand. Like, project-based learning is, like, the authentic learning, or?
Yeah, we could say that. Like, our project-based learning, like, you can learn, use online learning, or use online learning for, like, project-based assignments to make it authentic. And then another benefit of online learning is making it differentiated.
Yeah, because I agree that I think we should focus on differentiated because it's really a strong suit.
Okay, so Jessica, oh, there she is. She's back.
Oh, no. Jessica, can you hear us? I don't know.
Are you there, Jessica?
I don't know, because I keep seeing her leave the document, too, so she might be having computer issues. Focus on ready for my name.
To make learning authentic, and then the power.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. All right.
For the differentiated learning, I feel like I can take a second, but I have, like, some articles and stuff. because we've just been working on it so much in school that they've been like sending us all these articles and things of like why we're kind of moving towards like standards-based grading.
That's fine.
So I have a lot of resources for that.
I like that. So if you can find something like that, and then if we like need a specific tool for it, we could use yours or the iReady program that we use, because it's the kids want it, and you could have a kid doing 6th grade level math or the 3rd grade level math, but it's all through that one program.
Okay.
And it's like the program creates it. So that's the same thing like you guys, but you guys upload it. So.
I'm taking those
two. So I'm going to delete like ways to solve. I know we put like screencasts on the thing. I think I'm just going to delete that. It's like a couple of the things I added. So okay. That way it's more narrowed down now.
To like what are two topics?
Yeah. So like on the ways to solve, it just says like iReady, differentiated instruction, real world, authentic learning, project-based learning, formative assessments with instant feedback. I feel like that just goes along with the idea of online learning.
Okay.
For the evidence, I will add, I just put the G book. I will know what we're talking about. Are you there, Jessica?
I think I'm back.
Oh, yay. Okay.
Sorry. I was gone for a long time, too, so I don't know. I heard we're picking, like, three ideas, and then it cut out.
Okay.
Our two ideas.
So what we decided was focus on project-based learning as a way to make learning authentic and on the power to differentiate as the two ways to reimagine online learning.
Okay, perfect.
And then on the ways to solve, I deleted some stuff, so it's more narrowed down to specifically what we are focusing on. So, like, I put using iReady for, like, the differentiated part. And is that what the link that you put in there, Cassandra?
Oh, that's for project-based learning. I just labeled it. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, project-based learning. Okay, I see that now. So, like, ways to solve online learning would be, like, differentiated instruction, real world, authentic learning, frequent formative assessments with feedback. So I feel like we can use all those ideas and tie it into our two main concepts. For evidence, we'll use the G book when it comes to the authentic project-based learning. I don't know what other – I don't think we need to use all the stuff that I posted on there. I don't even think we need, like, maybe, like, three resources. I don't think we need to, like – it's only going to be, like, a 500 to 700-word paper, so I don't want to have, like, more than what we need and then be like, where I ran out of room.
Yeah,
definitely.
So
I'll find a couple that focus on like differentiated, and then we can kind of just look at them and decide from there like which ones we think are best to save for each topic.
Perfect. I'm just looking at the document that we have, and it says, how can we use TPAC? I know that he's really big on us incorporating that into our idea, so I don't know if you guys had any ideas with that.
Oh, gosh.
I have to refresh myself about TPAC.
Right? I was trying to think, because it's, like, in 8-10, that's when, like, I'm pretty sure I used, like, a spoon or a whisk.
Yeah. It's, like, or whatever. Yeah.
So it's, like, it's basically using a technology in a different way than what it's intended for. Is that what he's getting at, then?
Well, it's just, I think it's just making sure that you, like, that the, like, all of, like, the pedagogy, the way you teach and the technology, that it's, like, you're not making it harder. Like, you're not just taking technology, like, and putting it in there just to put it in there. It, like, that you're using the technology to, like, support the pedagogy that you're already using for that content.
Okay. All right.
So I guess and that's then, a good, we want to make sure that all of our, like, things are, like, bettering. But I think we picked two topics where, like, they are going to, like, support it. Like, you wouldn't just, you're not just using technology in projects or differentiated instruction. Like, it's really, truly helping.
Yeah, because like, instead of just typing, we're using a blog, so we're getting that feedback, and we're having an authentic. So I think we can definitely spin it easily to that.
Okay. So I'm going to delete what I had put about TPAC on here, because I thought, like, he wanted us to use a technology tool. for something else, like the Maker's Kit or something. Like, I thought he wanted like us to be using whisk and spoons and all. Like, I was a little confused on that. And I'm like, I don't get how you're like, I feel like technology, you can use it in a ton of different ways. So that kind of like it answers itself. Right. So, under the how can we use TPAC, what did you say about it? Cassandra, I feel like you had it worded really well.
We just want to make sure that we're picking resources that aren't making, like, you're not just using technology just to use it, okay. Which I don't think any of ours are. But we want to make sure, like, how, like, do you remember that chart where it's like your content knowledge, your technology knowledge, and your pedagogy knowledge, like they all overlap in the middle, and that's like TPAC?
Yeah. I don't
know if you remember that. So you just want to make sure that like you're integrating technology like meaningfully and purposefully. But I feel like we are, so I'm not quite sure how to like word that, but I'm going to focus on it. I'm pulling this up.
All right. I added on there, like, how will we address the issue? I think this is something Cassandra and I were trying to figure out when you were...
I think we lost her again. Oh, no.
All right. She just wrote on the group doc that she's trying to move because she lost connection.
Okay.
So how will we address this issue? What did we say that we thought it was? Like, we will address the idea of online learning through project-based. So it's basically like what you wrote under, how will we address reimagining online? Mm-hmm. That, never mind. We already answered that question. It's late. It's been a long time.
I feel you.
All right.
Okay, I'm going to try to save for this TPAC, like. So I just, like, went back to my, like, TPAC thing, and so it says, like, you want your content knowledge, your pedagogical knowledge, and technology knowledge all to cross. So it's basically asking, like, what are you teaching, how are you going to teach it, and then what tools allow you to, like, do that.
Okay.
So we can
and
say,
I think
like,
our topic. Oh, go ahead.
No, so that's exactly what I was going to say, what you were saying. Our topic kind of lends ourselves to that. Like, we are using, like, the TPAC idea with, like, with answering our question.
All right. Perfect. Okay. So the next thing, I guess, is, like, deciding, like, how we want to divide up the work and everything. So I think we have a good idea on, like, what we're doing and how we're going to solve it. We have to do the multimedia mashup, the visualization part, the curator tool, and the paper. Obviously, we probably should all write the paper because that's probably the thing we least all want to do. So... maybe, like, between the three of us, one can do a multimedia mashup, one can do the visualization part, and then one could be the curator for it.
Okay.
I don't know what you guys prefer to do, what you have more comfort doing. I'm fine with doing any of those three things, so...
I'm fine with any of them, too.
Yeah, I mean, I am too. I don't know. I I'm fine with any of you. I don't know if there's one that you guys, like, necessarily think, like, you are really good at. I don't know.
I know that, Cassandra, you said Popcorn Maker. Mm-hmm. I actually despise Popcorn Maker. It can be the most amount of problems that I've ever, like, I've never been
See,
so
that's
mad at.
See, everybody has said that, but when I did it for my project, it took, like, I agree that I, like, was really, like, I don't know if you guys took 811, right, where you made the, like, thing?
Yeah.
So I, like, took so much, like, hours and hours to line it all up, and mine, like, turned out. I was so proud that everyone was like, I hate it, like, it's so hard.
Yeah. I just didn't have the patience. I've used iMovie before, for a lot of the video and editing for like 8:10 when we had to record our making of something. But I've used iMovie for a couple things and like mashing up the things together. I don't think so. Like in the mashup, it has to be like video clips of this hangout, voiceover, some like us thinking about stuff, picture, and then just show our thinking. So it's like it should be pretty easy because it's like a 3-minute video clip. So I think iMovie would be the best way to solve that.
Okay. I actually have some clips too. I mean, some of them won't work as well as others, but I have clips like from like my school and some classrooms that like some of them don't fit our problem, but some fit like differentiated learning and PBL with like kids talking, and it's all like able to be used because we have like all the stuff signed and it's like already used in a lot of videos. So
okay.
I have them on Google Drive, so I could share some of those with you and see if like we think we could just cut a piece out. I think it'd be cool to have like students talking, so.
Right. Yeah, and then I don't think it'll be hard to find pictures or other videos on this stuff. Like we could even, I posted on the Google Doc a link from a TED talk, so we could even like pull from that TED talk.
Yeah.
For the visualization part of it, I like the idea of using Poplet. I feel like it's easy to like navigate and connect on stuff. I know it's like kind of taking the easy way out with him like suggesting it, but I was like, oh, I didn't think about it.
No,
that.
I think it's simple though.
Okay.
I'd rather do something that's like simple and like we know we're going to get our point across than trying something like too complicated.
So I guess
I was just making, so on our Poplet, what exactly are we putting on?
Like, I guess in the middle would be our topic, and then branch off one way with, like, authentic project-based learning, branch off the other way with differentiated instruction, like, put our resources and what we found. And then I guess the curator tool, TAC was mentioned, and then I mentioned Blend Space. So I don't know which one you guys prefer to use. So
I've never used either, but I was looking both of them up. I like searched both of them when he said them, and they both look kind of simple to use.
I've never used TAC. Jessica, I know that you said you used it before.
No, I just saw that he said it was his favorite.
I guess it doesn't matter. They're both pretty similar from what I've heard. I don't care. I guess whoever is the curator can decide what one they would rather use.
Yeah, that time with me.
Yeah.
And then as for the paper, I don't know like how we want to divide up the writing part of it.
Sorry, I'm trying to pull up the other.
Since the curating thing is just kind of putting it all together, if we want to divide up the paper, I don't mind just doing a paper. If that's easier. Aren't you just kind of throwing it all together?
Yeah. Well, do you want to, like... I mean, I don't want to make you write the whole paper, but...
It's a pretty short one. I don't mind.
Right. It is a pretty short paper. So if I guess if you want to, like, put together the paper, and then we can, like, obviously go back and edit it and comment and, like, insert our input as it goes. So if you want to take the paper...
I don't mind taking the mashup, the videos and stuff.
Okay, and then I can do the visualization Poplet. And I feel like that's kind of an easy thing to put together too, so I'll help you write the paper, Jessica, then if you need any part with that. And then I could do the curator too, since I'm doing the visualization.
And then if you put the paper in Google Docs, then we can just go, we wouldn't have to edit it ourselves, we could just use the comment feature to like... to help.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So, all right, so Cassandra, you'll do the mashup then. I will do the visualization. Jessica will be like in charge of organizing the paper, but I'll help with it. Don't worry. And then the curator, And then the curator tool, I'll just do that. And I'll probably just use Blend Space since that's what I used before.
Yeah.
And it's super easy with, like, pulling from your Google Doc and everything, too.
Okay.
So, I think that's it.
So he said the when did he say the draft is due that Friday?
November 30th. November 30th. I don't know if that's a Friday, Saturday, or Sunday.
I think that's a Sunday. Yeah. The final was due on a
Friday.
Yeah.
The 5th.
Well, I will probably work on the thing this weekend because I will have, like, a little bit of time to sit down.
I'll probably do it next. I'll probably work on my part next week, if that's okay with you guys.
Yeah,
I guess
that's fine.
We just need to, I guess we need to figure out what our specific resources are going to be.
Mm-hmm.
So that way, like, when I'm doing the visualization part and when the paper's being written, we're using the same information. So obviously we have to use the GU book. I don't know, maybe if we all want to, like, take time this week to look at resources and put it under the evidence part on the Google Doc and then narrow it down to, like, 3 to 4 by the end of the week.
Yeah.
Okay. So we can just, like, put our names next to which ones we like best and all that, and then we'll narrow it down from there if that works.
Yeah, so if we could say maybe, like, we'll just kind of put, like, our thoughts in this week, and then this weekend we'll make sure – By the end of the weekend, we have everything narrowed down.
Yeah.
So that we can each kind of use those to start working on our separate pieces that we're focusing on.
Perfect. That works.
Okay.
I feel like Jessica froze again.
Oh, no.
Okay. Are you there?
Yes. I don't know what's going on. I've never had problems. Sorry.
That's okay.
All right. So does that work for you then by Sunday, like, have our ideas all put in the Google Doc, figure out what our final resources are going to be, so that way next week we can start actually, like, doing the project.
Perfect. Sounds
okay.
Good.
All right. I think that's it.
Yeah.
All right. I think so. The link for the Google Hangout, Cassandra, is at the top for the YouTube page.
Oh, okay, okay.
So if you have any, like, trouble getting there or something, I'll just email it or switch it somehow to you. So.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Have a good night.
You too.
Bye.
Bye.